Today's episode of Nerd Soup is sponsored by Shudder. To try Shudder for free for 30 days, go to Shudder.com and use promo code NERDSOUP. That's Shudder.com and use code NERDSOUP. The Netflix for horror is a great way to describe Shudder. With the largest and fastest growing human-curated selection of thrilling and dangerous entertainment, horror fans of all kinds will find something to enjoy on Shudder without having to sit through ads or commercials of any kind. Shudder is all about the content, with new spine-tingling thrillers, shocking horrors, and edge-of-your-seat suspense added weekly. Your Shudder membership will also allow you to check out some of their original and exclusive content. One in particular that I think our audience would enjoy is this video essay, Leap of Faith, William Friedkin on The Exorcist. Now, you guys probably know we reviewed The Exorcist on this channel, and this video essay is a great look into the mind of the man who created this movie, all the influences, and really what he was trying to say with this film, and it was a very enjoyable 100 minutes, getting some really great insight into one of the most iconic horror movies of all time. Plus, you could stream The Unexpected on all of your favorite devices, including your iPhone, Android, Amazon Fire TV, Roku, and more. And remember, you can visit Shudder.com and use promo code NERDSOUP to try Shudder free for 30 days. But remember, we're not responsible for any nightmares you may have. So, go ahead, click that link, get to watching. Hello, everybody, and welcome back to another episode of Nerd Soup. I am Bo Oliver, joined here today by Aaron and Teddy. Wow, look at that. Ted was on the real review, and you're on the fake one. Look at that.
Yeah, how's it feel, man?
We're back to review The Mandalorian Season 2, Chapter 16, The Rescue.
Well, I was busy, so don't make it seem like this was a...
Oh, yeah, that is true.
We chopped it up pretty good. That was good. Good talk.
I haven't seen it yet. I'm waiting to see it like everyone else. One of the people on this one.
Oh, yeah. I was like, didn't we drop it already? No, we didn't.
Is there a reason why you didn't? I've been looking too.
Yeah, Ted's like, yeah, I can't wait to see it as well. Yeah, and we're back to talk about the final season, the final episode of Season 2 of Mandalorian. And, of course, you can listen to this review on Spotify, Google Podcasts, iTunes, find the audio-only version, even though this is basically an audio-only version as well. But, yeah, we're back. Finale. Ted, we gave our thoughts. Aaron, what do you think?
You guys didn't like it, did you?
Right. Yeah. Well, at this point, they've probably heard that review, so.
Yeah.
We weren't
a fan. Let's record under the impression, yeah.
Well, I thought it was a good episode. I mean, I thought, obviously, the fan service there with Luke, but that's the shit I want from Mandalorian. I thought that whole sequence is awesome. I think it packed an emotional punch with Din Djarin's goodbye with Grogu, and I kind of enjoyed that little siege of the ship. I don't think it was anything spectacular, mind-blowing other than Luke. I mean, that's the big thing, but I thought it was a great way to cap off the season.
Did you feel slighted that they took an easy way out with bringing Luke in?
You guys wanted Luke. Now you get Luke, now you're upset.
We wanted him in a
you
different...
You want Luke? Give you Luke.
We wanted him in a different sense, not in the sense we got him.
I thought it was very reminiscent, and I saw a lot of people talk about it, of the Vader scene in Rogue One. I wasn't expecting Vader to show up, but it was fucking awesome to see him go OP for that little sequence and the whole Luke sequence. This is finally like Luke Skywalker at the height of his abilities going fucking off, and I just enjoy that.
Yeah, this was the Luke Skywalker show. I forgot.
I'm so glad all the characters we spent 7 episodes with building just had nothing to do besides just be hostages. I'm not that mad about it, the ending. I'm upset about the ending, but overall I still very much enjoy the season.
Mm-hmm.
But your Rogue One point, I think now this season has the same problem that Rogue One does, where we're just going to do some stuff for 2 hours, and then the Vader moment, and that's all anyone remembers about that movie. The third act is very good, but the first two acts are bland, boring, uninspiring, unimaginative, and I wouldn't levy those criticisms at this episode, but I think you can claim that it is an easy way out.
I think
to bring Luke Skywalker into the episode in this capacity. I think that Rogue One has the same problem.
Which, what would have you rather him show up in? Or if you would want, like, I know you wanted him to show up.
Just a text message.
No, what we wanted was Mando to have his theatrical end in the ship, getting a W, and then going to bring Grogu to Luke and have that be Luke's thing, not him taking
He had his moments, too. And, I mean, a lot of the...
Did you enjoy the Moff Gideon stuff in this episode?
I think Moff, there's definitely more to be desired with that character. I think that was a little bit anticlimactic for, especially since we only got sprinkles with him throughout the series. So if this is it for him, then it's kind of like, I would have liked him to be more imposing, maybe have another plan. I guess he relied all on the Dark Troopers, and then he was pretty capable with the Darksaber, and I thought that was great too, him fighting Mando with him with his spear going back and forth.
I think that was the best action moment when he's got the spear, he's got the saber, he does that little kick move.
And I don't think Luke like hijacked the entire, obviously a big part, and that's a lot of what the discussion is following this episode, but
he got a WWE entrance in the middle of the Mandalorian.
Well, oh, look, it's an X-Men.
He came walking in like Vince McMahon.
Mando had his moments too. That showdown with Moff Gideon when he took down the first Dark Trooper when he was getting beat down and was able to work his way out of that. That I think the emotional moment with Grogu saying goodbye was probably one of, and him taking off the mask. That was, I thought, all.
His only fight scene with the Dark Trooper was him just getting punched and then taking the spear out and jamming it through the throat.
I kind of like that. He was getting beat up, and it kind of sets up.
He was getting beat up, but
yeah, it sets up that they're going to be they're not going to be able to beat these many Dark
Troopers.
It
was so obvious that somebody was coming to save them because there was 50 Dark
Troopers.
Right,
that's the thing. I don't mind Star Wars when it's predictable. You know that the good guys are going to win, but I don't want to be able to predict how they're going to win. When you think back of the season finale for season one, there are so many moments that you can remember. You remember IG-11 rolling in, the shootout. You remember the shootout inside of the bar. You remember IG-11 sacrifice. You remember Mando taking out the TIE fighter with his jetpack. There are so many iconic moments just packed into that finale. When you think back to this finale, it's just going to be Luke Skywalker. That's the moment that's always going to stand out. That's what everyone's going to speak about. And like Teddy, it's telegraphed from when they're talking about the Death Star. And at that point, I was still excited. Oh, we're going to get a Luke Skywalker appearance. It is hard to complain and bash on the moment because the moment, even when editing the review, man, that's fucking Luke Skywalker.
I know.
Yeah. He's looking good.
Listen, that whole scene, I loved every ounce of that entire scene. I just didn't like what they did with it and how they made it the backbone of the episode. And that's the only thing you remember from the episode.
But extend the episode by 20 minutes and then have that scene maybe. But you didn't need the Mayfeld development last episode. This episode should have started in chapter 15.
Well, I think this show, I mean,
doesn't derail the show whatsoever. I just think it's an anticlimactic ending. But it's still a very good season. I mean, some of these episodes,
they just focus too much on the ending, and like they just forgot about the whole like first 30 minutes of the episode.
I mean, a lot of the writing for this movie, for the show, is meant for it just to be enjoyed. It's not too deep. I mean, they telegraph everything, even back to the Mayfield episode when he mentioned to take off the helmet. They do that, and they kind of come through with their foreshadowing very quickly, and nothing like too articulate. It's just, this is what we set up, this is the payoff, but all of it's just fun. And that's like, I don't expect the show to have like deep writing like in Breaking Bad or Game of Thrones in the earlier seasons. I think it's just something where the show strives to be as much fun and enjoyable as possible.
Well, I didn't find this episode that fun.
Yeah.
You weren't having fun when Luke was just going through with that score blasting. I thought that was pretty cool.
No, because I was so taken out of it. I was already thinking about how I don't like this, if this is going to be the ending of this season, it's going to be disappointing. The action up until, I mean, Cara Dune, Fennec,
the girls
Koska
get a
Reeves,
done scene. Pretty much.
The girls get a done scene. I mean, they all look great, and it was funny when she was trying to get the weapon to unjam, but not memorable action moments for those characters. Boba Fett, he's got the great opening in the beginning when he's chasing the cruiser, and then he's gone. But and he's got his best scene comes at the very end, which is just
you
a
use
commercial
the end credit scene to show
like,
Boba Fett taking
Luke,
over the mantle.
So if you're going to say this was just...
And this also, the argument that it fixes The Last Jedi, that's the argument that I dislike the most. As someone who doesn't love that movie and who dislikes his arc even more than the movie itself, this doesn't make The Last Jedi better.
That's one thing I said on our review, is that this series started off with they're separating from the Skywalkers, and this is its own individual Star Wars story, and then now we're gradually getting into the Star Wars again, and they're trying to do patchwork now, it seems.
It was just a fun scene that connects the story to the larger Star Wars story, and I think
I don't mind going in that direction. I think there's just a better way to get there, and I can't complain too much because it's not like such a bad finale where I'm quitting the show for good. I'm still on board for season three, and I'm more interested in the political stuff that's going to happen, and of course Luke with Grogu, that opens up some interesting comic spinoffs.
But now what? Do you do a spinoff with Grogu and Luke?
No, I think...
Because Grogu, you have to bring this character back into the fold in some way. Because he's so fucking important to the marketing of Star Wars at this point.
But just one last thing, though. Luke, like, you guys saying he hijacked... Like, this isn't the first time this show has introduced a character first. Like, look at Ahsoka this season. They brought her character in just kind of to set up her own spinoff. They did the same thing with Boba Fett. So having Luke come in isn't like some crazy out of left field thing for the show.
It wasn't a finale, though.
They bring in other characters. They let them have their moments, that well-known characters at that, with Boba, Ahsoka, and now Luke. And then
I want to know your thoughts on the CGI. Do you think they should have went real person, or are you happy with the CGI?
It's something where...
They just deal with it next season.
Stop playing with that, Bandy.
It's something where if we... It's tough, because if we never get Luke again, then I guess it's fine. But they bring him back, and they have to do CGI again for an extended period of time. I would have rather them go with a younger actor. But I could see both sides of that argument. I think Sebastian Stan would have been a good fill-in, but there's other people that are just... Like Mark Hamill is Luke. So obviously they can't get him now to play the character, so this is the next best thing. And that's his character. He should only play him. So...
In the flashbacks, though, when they show Ben Solo taking out the Jedi, he was his age, though, wasn't he? He wasn't a young Luke Skywalker. So can't they bring back Mark Hamill if they really want to? If they want to flash, if they want to.
No, Last Jedi, that flashback was probably...
He didn't look that young. He looked like he was like what he was right now.
Ben's probably maybe 10 years, maybe. I don't know the exact dates.
I think you could definitely like make Mark Hamill look like he's in his mid-50s with movie magic. But we don't know where they're going to jump around to. Do they take that with Mark Hamill coming back? I don't know. It's the CGI, the more I look at it, when he first took off the hood, I wasn't focusing on it at all. I was like, holy shit, that's Mark Hamill.
Well, you kind of know right away.
Yeah.
Like the same thing with Leia. Tarkin, I didn't really notice too much when they did that in Rogue One.
On the big screen, for people who weren't ready for Tarkin, didn't notice it at all.
But Tarkin's not like...
But I knew Tarkin was coming, so when I first saw him, I was impressed that they had the balls to go there. I thought Luke, I guess they have the advantage of having Mark Hamill, so it was easier for them.
But for like Luke and Leia, it's like once they showed up, you obviously, like, there's just nothing in my brain that's like, this is obviously CGI.
Right, right.
So I'm able to get by that pretty quickly, though.
A couple of his head nods looked okay when he's looking
down
at
Grogu. Some of the
mouth
movements were a little odd.
His hair looked fake.
Yeah.
The face looked more real than the hair, which was weird.
But it kind of looked like he was like force ghosting. It looked like.
Yeah, I guess the argument for a live action actor is if you want to bring him back and kind of continue. I suggested on our first review that if they did bring back CGI Luke, they could kind of just keep him in the shadows, that he's off training with other Jedi and we're focusing on Grogu.
Yeah.
Same planet, but Grogu's training under...
With a team, maybe?
Yeah, special counselor Mace Windu that just hired.
Hold on.
just kidding.
Well, that's the thing, too, with Grogu is...
Yeah, man, no Mace Windu now, huh?
I think you and I are the only two people on the planet who wanted Mace Windu.
I think that would have been awesome, too, but I wasn't expecting it. But with Grogu now...
At any point, did you think it was someone else?
The X-Wing was kind of like, okay.
I was waiting for the platoon to come back. Like, oh, one X-Wing?
I did
2 seconds later, 70 X-Wings
when I saw that X-Wing.
But I wasn't like completely like, I'm like, is that Luke? Like, other people have X-Wings, right?
Like, that's what I was saying. I was like, there's no way they bring Luke back.
It's a popular ship.
You know, and then
you saw the one glove.
When you saw the green and then the look, it's like... And
Mark Hamill, you're like, okay, this might be Luke.
When he says, I'm Luke Skywalker.
I thought for a second Grogu was going to like say... to Luke that he wants Mando to come with him. I thought that's how it was going to
happen. What's he going
to do? Like, Teddy wanted Mando to train under Luke.
Yeah. Not Jedi-wise, just, you know, a lesson from Luke? You tell me you can't learn anything?
Well, the idea of them splitting up, just from a business standpoint...
For how long?
...had to have made Bob Iger... a little a little apprehensive. Well,
yeah,
whoa,
you want to do that?
Back, right?
He's coming back. He has to, right?
Right. So what do you think is going to happen?
I don't know. That's the thing, because how long until Ben Solo like gets real emo and starts killing everybody?
Well, it does seem like we are still
10 years
away.
Yeah.
I think it's 15 years from when he destroys the temple.
Okay. I saw people suggesting that Grogu is going to train with Luke, get a better hold on his powers, but leave behind the Jedi to reunite with Mando. and eventually help Mando.
Is he making decisions like that already?
Is someone taking Grogu again?
It's kind of just, yeah.
This guy keeps getting snagged.
He's going through life, just vibing.
Well, the idea of, I don't know, do you think he'll be in Mandalorian Season 3?
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe.
Because now it seems like he's going to be a presence that shows up at the very end of the
Luke
season.
Luke just returns him. It's like, this kid sucks.
Yeah, he's just a terrible, no manners. You damn Mandalorians.
Oh, yeah, and that's one thing I didn't like either about this episode. They ended Mando's storyline pretty much. That's what it felt like. They didn't push him forward with a new mission. No ideas for what he can be doing now. We have no idea what he can be doing in season 3.
You have the advantage of season 1. It's a new character, so you can kind of just peel back some of the layers and get some information about him. And he's not that three-dimensional of a character anyway. But we really didn't learn anything new about Mando this season. Other than that, he's getting in touch with his humanity again because he's got this adopted son.
And he has a Darksaber.
But, they kind of end this...
I didn't get that part. When Bo-Katan was like, it's like, no, I got to fight you for it.
It's kind of like a Game of Thrones thing, right? I didn't earn this sword, the story. But what's a story worth in a galaxy with a bajillion fucking people? Nobody knows who everyone is, yet everybody knows everything. Like, you just... Like, when Mando said, I yield, take it. That's all you need to do, right?
Yeah, exactly. Now what?
She fought Moff Gideon.
Everybody in here?
Koska Reeves is going to, like, go on Twitter and tweet, she didn't really exactly. It. It was actually Pedro
Pascal.
Tell
them the truth, but leave some parts out. Be like, yeah, we snored Moff Gideon's...
Yeah,
and then ship. He surrendered, and I took the Darksaber.
That's all you need to do.
She was tight when he walked in with the saber.
You need a focus group. I know she was.
She was tight.
I was upset. I was.
What's that?
I would have been upset if that was like the conclusion, like them fighting over the Darksaber.
Yeah, that would have been awful. Well, I think it was their way of positioning Mando as the hero of Mandalore.
I don't think Bo-Katan wins
to claim the throne.
Do you?
Against Mando?
No, against Moth. I don't think Bo-Katan gets the saber off Moth.
Oh, I think she would do just fine.
You think so?
Well, she had the sphere, maybe. Moff's not, he could handle the thing.
When he started hacking away and he's guarding with his with his armor instead of the actual spear, that was cool. But, I don't know. If
he's
Bo-Katan
denting the metal,
could have taken him out.
Getting hit with the... Oh, yeah, and that's another thing. The dark troopers, they're saying that like they replaced the droids with... the humans with droids, and they just act like droids. There was no like sophistication with them.
Yeah, Dark Troopers, we're a little underwhelming.
Just punching like robots.
It's the cannon fodder that I asked for a couple weeks ago. If we see Luke, I just want to see him taking out cannon fodder. That's exactly what we got.
You hated it.
And I didn't like it. No. Wasn't a fan. I've become the Star Wars fan that just you can't
be happy.
Yeah, you can't appease him.
And another thing, like in the beginning, I thought the Sasha Banks and Boba Fett fight. I was like, what is this? Why are they?
I brought that up in the review. I'm like, why does everybody care who's who? It's like,
who the hell is
wait a
Sasha
minute.
Banks?
She's the other Mandalorian, not Bo-Katan.
Bo-Katan
I don't know
psychic.
Her name.
Why'd you call her Sasha Banks?
That's her name in real life from WWE.
I brought that up in the review. The second Boba Fett and Mando walk in, Bo-Katan starts calling out Boba Fett, saying that he's a disgrace to the armor. Why do you care? We're all on the same team.
That's usually Mando's move, too.
Yeah, it is, actually.
They get real upset about people wearing their armor.
Well, I guess they're going to dive more into that moving forward. We don't know the state of Mandalore. Apparently, it's just a wreck after what the Empire did to it.
Yeah.
And we don't know if we're going to see more. I mean, we did actually see we don't know where those Mandalorian went. Remember the Mandalorian from season 1 that had to
take their helmets off?
Yeah,
leave,
they had to dip out of that hiding spot. So I wonder if that will be a point of contention that the other Mandalorians don't really want to follow Din because he comes from this kind of extremist offshoot.
Maybe he's changing now, though. He took his helmet off of everybody.
Yeah, he's gradually coming around to just being a normal person.
Yeah. Would you mind them going back to Adventure Week? Like, episode? That's what I would want them to do.
No, I think that they have
Grogu.
To go away from that now.
You think so?
Yeah, I mean, if he's got the Darksaber, if they're setting up this Mandalore stuff, I think now is where you go big picture for a season. Rather than... Because with the Adventure of the Week, it's fun because you got Mando and Grogu. I think that's how you get away with it. I was disappointed, I mentioned this on the other review, that Grogu doesn't have any hero moments this season. And in season 1, he had like 3 or 4.
The baby.
Yeah, he's a baby, but last season he was picking up rhinoceroses, he was healing Carl Weathers, he was blowing back the explosions. They didn't really find...
He was going off season 1.
Yeah, they didn't find any creative ways to use him. And that's when you mentioned that you don't need Star Wars to be Game of Thrones. It's like, no, you don't, but you do need to keep it unique and fun and creative. And I think... just bringing back a character like Luke, not focusing the attention on your main characters. It hurts the ending for me.
If that was Ahsoka that flew in, would you have any different opinions? Or
I still wouldn't love it. Ahsoka, I guess you get the pass of maybe she was on their trail.
Yeah,
she's been keeping an eye on them. I guess it makes more sense. But I'd rather they go out like they did in season one. Where season one, they managed to have that explosive ending, and then it just ended with Din versus Moth, TIE Fighter, jetpack. Small, but still epic.
Hmm.
With what they did with
Moth. Like I said, we can't really complain that much. Yeah, Teddy even said that on the review. I feel bad about, you know, it's like I feel like I'm calling my own son ugly. I still love you, but you're a little ugly.
Yeah, it's like I don't want to do this. I don't want to like not like this episode, but I could not like what they did with it, but
maybe
still
because
enjoy it.
I just watched Return of the Jedi the night before this. It was just like, I know.
You were still
it was
fresh.
So fresh, like Luke, yeah. Like, so every time you watch Return of the Jedi, it's like, oh, what happened between now and Force Awakens?
I mean, as a kid, I used to dream about that, dude.
This is what happened.
That was my biggest what if as a kid, continuing a franchise.
Because the saber fight at the end of Return of the Jedi, it's very good. But like in terms of what I grew up with Star Wars, it's, you know, it's very much of its time. I still love it, and I think it is one the better. Well, I don't know if it's better than the Empire fight, but it's definitely an improvement off of the Obi-Wan Vader fight. And it's kind of that middle ground between the over-stylized, super choreographed, and the super basic, which I enjoy. But this was like...
Yeah, you want to see Ip Man, Luke Skywalker.
Yeah, this was like, holy shit.
You want to see him tossing people around.
He was so badass, man. He Moss tried killing himself. The second he saw the TIE Fighter,
he's like, he was terrified.
The X-Wing. It's like,
and his movements
that's the amount
were,
of fear this one guy has.
They were so smooth. He had great form.
Hit him with the back.
Taking his time, just strolling throughout the ship.
You think the Dark Troopers sensed? Did the Dark Troopers have any kind of force powers, like sensitive?
It looks like they didn't, no.
No.
They just knew to kill him.
Also, speaking of Gideon and Cara Dune wanted to keep him alive so she can question him.
Right.
Is that going to be the start of...
That's what I don't want. They ended season one with Moth Gideon so perfect. He had his whole episode, and then they bring him back for what? For this?
Well, no. What I mean is, like, is that going to be the start of... What's that other spinoff series? Following the Republic officers?
Yes.
So is that going to be them following up on that information?
Right.
Or is that going to be something Mando takes into his own hands?
Well, we were saying that they should have told Luke, hey, they were using this kid's blood to do something. You might want to check that out. But then I realized that Cara Dune is probably going to relay that information to the New Republic, and it will eventually get into the hands of Leia.
And Grogu can tell him, too.
Well, an interesting part of the Star Wars universe at this time is that the government, Congress, if you will, was still very skeptical about the existence of a First Order. Leia kept pushing it, and everybody was calling her a warmonger, that she's just this old warmonger who's always trying to rile people up.
Don't they find out Vader's her dad?
Yeah, they find out, like, because she's about to become basically the president of the New Republic, and then they release that information. It's like a big scandal. Like, Tucker Carlson's like, she wants to be a woman of the people?
You got the droids playing in the bars. on the TV.
Crowd just shaking their heads. I used to love that woman.
Well, you still like Boba Fett shit himself when he flew up to the fucking...
Picturing Tucker Carlson now on the Galactic
the Galactic
the Empire,
news.
Like the news.
You saw Boba Fett shit his pants.
Leia Organa wants to rule the galaxy. Her father, Darth Vader. How did that go?
I'm questioning
not
why
great.
Tucker Carlson is so good. How much do you watch Tucker Carlson?
It's like a big meme now. Everyone's like doing their Tucker Carlson impersonations. So I'm like, I gotta.
What were you gonna say, Ted?
Nah, it was nothing big. I just said, but when Boba Fett flew up to go after Grogu, we showed the Imperial ship and shit his pants.
So that would have been a funny reunion, huh? Luke and Boba Fett. Like, hey, aren't you dead?
Nope.
Like, hey, aren't
what
you?
What if Luke was
Mark
thinking
Hamill?
When he like took his helmet off? He's like, why is this a big deal? I didn't see the last couple episodes.
Yeah, right. So I don't know if that spinoff show with Cara Dune focusing on the New Republic. I'm assuming that's what they're going to get into. Because Moff Gideon, even in this episode, once again, hinted at the First Order. And I think Moff Gideon is another character who has that connection with Mandalore. He was the individual ruling over Mandalore when it was taken by the Empire. So I don't know if he comes back into the... Because the way he was negotiating, I guess he was kind of lying to Din It made it seem that he really wanted the sword so that he could be the one to restore Mandalore. And I think that was just...
Yeah, I didn't buy that for a second.
He almost fooled me. Not gonna lie. Like, maybe he just wants the Darksaber.
Why would he suddenly care about Mandalore?
Yeah.
So I don't know if they'll bring him back in a way where he does care about the politics of Mandalore. But
you think Snoke's coming back eventually?
I think we're going to see Snoke in one of these shows.
And this is the patchwork I'm talking about.
I mean, they have to have the Vegas odds. Yeah. Well, I don't mind Snoke patchwork because I think there's story there. I mean,
that's what it should have been. We're getting it now. What we should have gotten in episode 6.
It's kind of like the comics. It's like a comic book brought to life that tells you these little intricate stories that connect to the larger universe, which, you know, getting to see that all play out, I find very intriguing. I think even the biggest fans of Mandalorian can accept it's not the greatest show in the world, but it's just very entertaining. And a lot of people consider it like the best Star Wars content we've gotten since Empire.
I would say that I still think it is.
They're doing CPR work right now, man.
Well, like, when I go back and watch season 2 in one sitting, I'm going to enjoy it. Back to back to back to back to back to back to back.
And they're so short where it's not like it's a long time.
Yeah. And, you know, they have seasons 3, 4, and 5 to go. This is not... But this
I want to go that far. I still think Revenge of the Sith and even Force Awakens I still love, so...
Right.
And Rogue One, too. I don't know why you hate on Rogue One.
But when Teddy said earlier this year, or earlier in our reviews, I forget which review it was on, that possibly Grogu and Mando could go their separate ways, I almost cut it out of the review because I didn't think that was a possibility whatsoever. This felt like a series finale. Maybe if this was like a series
finale...
It could
have been, yeah.
Then maybe it's better. Because it's just like, oh, fuck, we're all out of options here. And then Luke fucking Skywalker saves the day. You know, if you had four or five years of these characters winning their battles, and then they get bailed out at the very end.
I saw some theories, too. It could have just been a baby seeing, like, a shiny robot and going to hug it. But people were like, oh, does R2 and Grogu know each other? Mm. Like, have they ever interacted?
Teddy did bring that up.
He shit his pants, R2, when he saw Grogu.
People were speculating maybe he was able to, like... While he was waiting for Anakin to kill the younglings, he snuck in, took Grogu, and got back into the ship. I don't know. Because R2 is with Anakin when all that shit happens.
Do you think he's
on the ship. Maybe he was able to sneak in
there. R2 really does get dragged around for that whole serial killing massacre.
Do you guys think that eventually they're going to answer that question?
Say that again?
Of who took Grogu. Do you guys think they're going to answer that question? Who took him?
I don't think it's a question that they necessarily have to answer. But yeah, that would be a great flashback, right?
Yeah.
Kind of get a new perspective on the Jedi Temple, because those scenes always look so great when Anakin is storming into the Jedi Temple that first time with the stormtroopers at his back.
Mm-hmm.
And even when Obi-Wan...
That's so dark.
Dude, that movie does. That's the only... Besides the sequel trilogy, before the sequel trilogy, it was the only PG-13 Star Wars, Revenge of the Sith. And that's why
it's like the rating, and it gives you the reason why. It's like violence, fantasy elements...
genocide.
Children being slaughtered.
Children massacre.
We don't see the slaughter, but...
No. The way it's directed is... It's perfectly directed. The way Lucas was... He was in his bag in that third movie. But that's why his excuse, oh, these movies are for kids, is bullshit. He only uses that when somebody doesn't like his movie. Because then you got Anakin murdering children in Revenge of the Sith.
Well, you can do the Harry Potter defense.
Right.
First two were kids.
Right, yeah. It's kind of got similar vibes to Harry Potter, the way that the violence increases, but yeah, it never goes to that R-rated territory. And Star Wars never has to be R-rated.
Imagine.
But getting another look, getting a different perspective, Grogu's perspective during that massacre, that would be... I'd love to see that. Love to see it.
Oh, I'm out of here.
Yeah, right? It's just him doing the Fred Flintstone legs, dipping in that little ass pot of his. Yeah, I mean, I guess we'll just talk about the future here. I mean, do you have any way in which you would want to see Grogu and Luke brought back in? I mean, if you had to take any guesses?
That's tough, too. Like, what's the reasoning? There has to be, like, a solid reason for either Mando to go retrieve him or Luke to give him back. Maybe there's a threat and...
Didn't Mark Hamill say that he kind of
sensed... It could be the end of Grogu until, like, a comic comes out and tells that story.
But that's the thing from a marketing perspective. How do you sideline this guy?
Well, maybe
he's taken over the internet the last 2 years.
Yeah. Maybe they were just like, that's like Filoni and Favreau, or just like,
That doesn't matter.
They had to have a plan, right?
You know, how long are we going to milk this out if we don't have good stories and nothing? Is he just going to be the sidekick baby cooing along on these adventures every week? Or
right.
Something's got to give here. And, you know, maybe they're not going to be subservient to whatever the marketing and the higher ups at Disney want to do. It's like, no, the story ran its course. We got him where he wants to go to, and now we want to tell the story of The Mandalorian, because that's what the show's called.
Does he pop up in any other spinoff?
He should pop up in every single one.
Grogu? They should always just have an episode dedicated to what Grogu's doing.
Yeah, it's only right.
Yeah, I mean,
because you don't,
he needs a retirement tour. Is it.
What if they announced like a Jedi Temple show?
Prequels? Stuff?
No, with Luke Skywalker with the CGI.
Training?
Yeah.
You can't do a whole show with CGI.
No, you can't, right? So that's why I feel like they have to give us something in live action.
They dug themselves a hole trying to make that theatrical Luke entrance.
Well, that's the thing. I think they're going to go back to it.
You could do a cartoon, maybe?
I also kind of like the idea of Luke Skywalker just kind of weaving in and out of the universe during this gap between the original trilogy and the sequel trilogy. But I feel like you have to go back there. You have to show us young Ben Solo. You have to show us the new generation of Jedi.
Aren't there comics?
There are comics, yeah. So I guess they could tie it into the comics in some way. Because, they get into a lot of Ben Solo. And there's a comic that's the thing. I don't know if he killed those kids or didn't at this point. Because the comic leaves it ambiguous as well. The comic makes it seem like there's a chance Kylo Ren didn't murder these kids. And if Kylo Ren would tell it, he didn't murder those kids. That's what he says in The Last Jedi, right? Don't they kind of do that in The Rise of Skywalker as well?
Well, like the point
of view,
didn't
they address that he didn't kill the kids? Nobody knows anymore.
They tried to do a lot for Kylo in that movie.
Talk about a butchered arc. Holy shit. Can't wait to talk about that movie on the Revisited.
Never forget, though, I gave it a 6.
Okay.
After the first time, right? The Last Jedi.
Oh, The Last Jedi?
Yeah.
No, I mean The Rise of Skywalker. Yeah. So that's, I'll give you that.
I actually really enjoyed, I didn't love it, but after leaving Rise of Skywalker, I'm like, you know, a little rush, but that was a lot of fun. But yeah, we'll save that for
it. It was
a
big rush, that movie.
Big time rush.
It's like taking down 5 pixie sticks.
Oh, now once. When I think back to it, I get sick. Did a hell of a lot, though, for views. Shout out.
That was
to
true,
Apple,
yeah,
too.
Yeah. We need another, what's our theory moving forward now?
You gotta call something. Someone's gotta make a call here.
Yeah.
We should have made the Luke Skywalker showing up in Mando video. Well, Mando, you know, moving forward.
Mace is coming next season. Start it up.
I'm down.
Moving forward with Mando and those supporting characters, who do you think stays within the inner circle moving forward in season 3? Well, is it going to focus on characters like Bo-Katan?
I would assume so, because that's like the biggest, I guess, cliffhanger of this season is he has the Darksaber. Bo-Katan wants to earn it somehow. And that's just conflict right there.
Do you think that they team up? That it becomes I'm serving you now, Din? Are going to be the one we put on the throne?
Well, she's apparently the heir apparent. She's the heir apparent, right?
Yes.
And I don't think this is something she's worked very hard for. I don't think she's just going to give it up that easy, especially when Din Djarin doesn't. It's fucking Game of Thrones.
I think Mando's going to
want
it.
Her whole life, the heir apparent, trying to take it back. Jon Snow didn't want it. And
yeah.
So we're going to have that dynamic. Hopefully she doesn't just blow up like an Alderaan.
Well, there's another character, Sabine, who was in Rebels, who had the Darksaber, and she left it with... That's how Bo-Katan got the Darksaber. It was given to her by Sabine.
But that was like the same clan, right?
Yeah.
So it's a little different.
But I wonder if that character comes into play next season. People thought we were going to see her this season. I just wonder where those characters are headed. Like I said, I'm sure that they'll create new villains, they'll create new adversaries that are also in the business of restoring Mandalore, and they have other ideas. Maybe Din comes into conflict with the former Mandalorian death cult members that he was running around with.
You think Boba Fett tosses him some bounties? Because Boba Fett is ruling underworld right now.
Do you think he goes back to bounty hunting?
I think he does.
Yeah.
I think he's sitting pretty in the palace.
Well, no, he's saying, does Boba Fett tell Mando?
Think he'll bring
Mando,
the band back?
That weird singer? Please don't bring her back.
Well,
that
we do
talk
need,
about bad CGI.
We need that band back in the cantina. That's what we need.
The Jizz Whalers?
Are they touring again?
No, it's with COVID, man. They can't. It's all at home.
Yeah, but I really don't know. I get, like I said, I think that's the only like avenue or any clues we have as far as a potential overarching storyline for next season. But oh, we just gotta wait and see. We got a whole year.
Like, you didn't put Boba Fett on like King of the Underworld for no reason.
Well, they did it for the show.
For his show, I know, but to push Mando too. It's gotta be something to do with him.
Not necessarily. They did the same thing with Ahsoka.
Just bring her in.
They brought her in, set up the series, and now Thrawn got cast, and that show's going to happen.
Well, it's interesting because apparently Mando Season 3 and the Boba Fett show are coming out next December at the same time. And there was some confusion where people were saying, is Boba Fett just Mando Season 3? So I wonder if some of those episodes will have some just real-time crossover, you know? Like this week's episode of...
Bro, what would be sick?
Boba Fett leads into next week's episode of Mando. Shit like that. Yeah,
that'd be sick. Like they do Boba Fett on Tuesday, Mando on Friday, something like that.
Right, there's precedent for that with the CW. I'm pretty sure the CW has done that, where they have seasons running at the same time in the episodes. I mean, they do the giant episode crossover event every year, or when the shows were on.
That's unique.
This episode has the highest IMDb score ever, with a 9.9.
Yeesh.
Boy, these
we're gonna get killed.
Yeah, we're gonna get fucking massacred.
People love the fan service.
Yeah,
man.
They do. They really do.
Are we cutting the first one and redoing it?
Yeah, no, I think saying we should. How much we love it. I think it's time to just delete that.
we might lose season eight.
Luke Skywalker coming back. Thank you guys for joining us for our review of The Mandalorian Season 2, Chapter 16, The Rescue, spoiler discussion.
At least Aaron liked it. If he didn't like it, oh no.
Yeah, that's it. Now you get
Aaron's
some more clout.
Now. Yeah.
Aaron's the best Nerd Soup member.
Redemption.
That's a season one episode. All right, guys, thank you for joining me. And we will be back with more Star Wars reviews, actually. We're coming out with our Return of the Jedi revisited video within the next week, hopefully, maybe less.
Nice.
Never know with us, keeping you on your toes. And for Aaron, Teddy, I am Bo Oliver, signing off.
Are we just bad at our jobs?
Yeah.
With what?
This is the way.
Yeah.
Being on the wrong side of history every time.
Every single time.
Well, would you look at that? It's finally over. Hey guys, Bo Oliver here for one final send-off. Now, before I beg you guys to like and share this video, I'd like to thank our very special Patreon pledgers. We are very proud of the community we've been able to build here at NerdSoup, and it would not have been possible without our Patreon supporters. You guys are the true MVPs of this channel. Everything I've said, you keep the fridge full, you keep the lights on. There aren't enough words to thank you guys, but we'll do it anyway. Thank you. And we have a few videos coming up that have been suggested to us by Patreon pledgers. My Hero Academia, Neon Genesis Evangelion, and Full Metal Alchemist will be reviewed by Marissa, and yours truly, and Castlevania, which will be reviewed by Marissa and Aaron. And if you'd like to consider donating to our Patreon page, you can visit patreon.com/nerdsoup and check out some of the rewards we offer to our listeners. And really, we'd like to thank everyone who takes the time out of their day to watch our videos. Patreon pledger or not, your support is what keeps us motivated to keep giving the world our opinions on movies and TV shows and video games and pop culture, even though no one asked for it. We're still here, we're still yapping, and we hope you continue to join us. I'm Bo Oliver, and I support this message.